Please note that this video has spoilers for the subject. Put off by how long this video is. Don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. The Rules of Attraction, movie thoughts. I want to talk about food service girl slash suicide slash. That was not the most elegant way to start, and I swear that was not intentional, but I'm gonna leave it in rather than retake this. But before I talk about her, is what I was getting at, I want to talk about suicide attempts in the film in general. When we first... When we meet, I think his name is Harry, the freshman, he's at the party, and it's like, you know, he's talking about how, you know, you really shouldn't do ecstasy, and, you know, it has this, you know, and Paul is like saying, whatever, if you're going to be boring, whatever, you know, and it's actually kind of, you know, Paul... You know, it kind of goes how Paul, you know, Paul would rather be by himself in there with, you know, yeah. But the next time we see Harry, we don't immediately know that it's him that's being talked about, but Paul is preparing for the date. You know, I love that, you know, Raymond bursts in, talks about, you know, oh, we have to go help him. And Paul just keeps standing there looking at the two shirts. And Raymond, you know, after a few seconds of really worrying about Harry, and in between worrying about Harry, he's like, that one's too gay. You know, just, I'm standing here, you're holding them up. Just so you know, that one is too gay. And, you know, and Paul accepts it. He's like, well, it's got to be the other one then. And yeah, that's just, wow. And yeah, and then, you know, they run in and see Paul, rather, Harry. And yeah, there's a, you know, you maybe don't even recognize him at first, but that is Harry again. That is the kid who, and you know, maybe that's why he's talking about how he doesn't want to do E. And Paul has still not really taken his OD seriously. You know, he's still just, you know, talking to him like, eh, whatever. If you don't want to do drugs, I don't have time for you right now. You know, and it's just, and it's not like Harry isn't still at a party or something. You know, he didn't say, you know, I mean, if you're ODing, I don't personally have a problem with drugs. I think that it's more that, you know, people who abuse drugs, it's that they have some need that's not being fulfilled. I have more sympathy with them than anything, but you know, yeah, I don't think that, you know, having done drugs or doing drugs or something makes you a bad person or anything. But yeah, you know, ODing or trying to commit suicide via drugs and the like, it means that there is something that you really, you know, and said, you know, he found out this morning he was adopted. So yeah, you know, it might be that, but that doesn't, you know, he's still there at the college, you know, at the end of that semester. He didn't leave. He didn't drop out or something. His, you know, like OD kind of situation didn't change anything really. It's, you know, and this is again, you know, the first time you watch it, you may not even fully realize, because, you know, it's right there at the start, and you don't see Harry particularly there near the end, you know, even though it's still the end of the world party. And yeah, this kid did not, you know, for all we know, he didn't even like miss class particularly, or, you know, no more than usual. It didn't do anything. It didn't change anything. And he's not, you know, maybe he's a little more cautious about drugs now, but yeah, it's this thing that, yeah. And you know, the way that every suicide attempt in this seems to be about some kind of like personal thing. It's not that they are overwhelmed by the evil in the world. It's not that, you know, it's not for some spiritual thing. With Harry, it was that he found out he was adopted. In the script, it even says that Harry called Raymond before dinner, and then Raymond went to check on him after dinner. So, you know, I mean, gotta eat, right? And yeah, it's each suicide attempt, every other suicide attempt than that, you know, whether it works out or not, is because someone feels that the person they want doesn't want them. And that really, yeah, it really speaks to that these people deeply, sincerely need something. It's not necessarily another person, because if you enter a relationship with the mindset that this other person will complete my life, that's just not going to work out. Another person cannot, you cannot be another person's happiness. A person has to be happy and then get into a relationship. And yeah, it's, and yeah, these people feel that need so deeply that they attempt suicide. And they, you know, and you could, you know, extend that to Harry. Maybe he feels that he, you know, with his parents not being his biological parents, that, you know, that means he's lost someone that he needed. And again, it leads to him doing something like that. You know, we don't know for sure if it was necessarily a suicide attempt. You know, not every OD is an intentional OD or an intentional suicide attempt. But yeah, you know, they don't take from that their happiness has to come from somewhere else. They don't take from that their life lacks depth. I have the greatest of sympathy for anyone who has or will consider suicide. But if you truly consider it, again, it might be that there is something in your life that you feel just does not satisfy you. And before you do anything, just think hard if maybe, what is that saying? This too shall pass. Maybe there is a way out of the situation you're in. Maybe it doesn't. And maybe if it's because you've lost a person who was close to you, even if it's like, you know, I mean, being dumped sucks, but I, you know, I especially understand if it's someone who, you know, if someone close to you dies or that kind of thing, where it's genuinely, that person will never be in your life again, and that person, yeah. And that was not, you know, because someone wanted to be, to leave your life. That was just, you know, so, but I feel like I'm talking someone into suicide. Try to see if there isn't something that can make you feel like life is still worth it. And yeah, it's, and then you have how others react to these suicide attempts. The Paul's immediate reaction, and he doesn't even hide it from the others, is, I've got somewhere to be. This is like, I might, you know, I'm supposed to go on a date with someone I care about, and this is interfering with that. There is, it's not clear whether it's just been that many suicide attempts that he just doesn't even take it seriously anymore, or whether it's just that for once he actually cares about the person that he's, you know, trying to sleep with, or if it's just that he's that cold in general, that the moment something he wants is being at least postponed. Again, this is not like, you know, Sean is leaving town and I mean never see me again. This is like, call and reschedule? You know, it's, but that is something I, nobody ever call, if nobody in this has ever seen calling the other person's cell phone. I mean, 2002, people would still have had cell phones, especially, you know, people who have the money to go to college and such. You know, it's not like super, yeah, but it's, we never really see them. See, I mean, that's what I would do if I was one of these people, at least call, maybe try to set up a date, rather than just hoping you run into each other at the next party, you know. I mean, Paul at least does, Paul's the most forward of them all. He's like, we can go on a date, I'll buy, you know, that, that might actually lead to a relationship. You know, the others, it's just, maybe I'll see you at the next party. And, you know, well, I'm thinking about the other person or something, but yeah. Anyway, no cell phone. That gets, yeah, back to Paul with Harry and Raymond, and I forget the last one's name, but yeah, it's like, that's the reaction, you know. I have better things to be doing with my time than helping this freshman don't OD. What did he OD on? You know, and I'm not an expert, but I think he was right in what he said. You know, what did he OD on? Wine coolers. And, you know, and then he goes and he looks at the, you know, wine bottle. I'm pretty sure that Paul was actually right about that. So again, it's that kind of, you know, the others are extremely emotional, but he knows this. This is not new to him. And maybe the others always react like this, and he's just sick of it. Nonetheless, it is this really ugly reaction to something like that, you know, not taking it seriously. And just, yeah. And then at the end of the day, I mean, they drive to the hospital, and then, you know, but by then Harry is lucid. He's responding. I mean, they're still carrying him out of there, but, you know, at the end, they don't seem to be getting a lot of help from the hospital itself. So he might actually still need help from the hospital, but they're not getting it, that's for sure. Yeah, it's, and that's the, you know, the running thing, that might actually be why Paul is so dismissive towards Harry there at the end. You know, no one's twisting your arm. I don't even know why I'm bothering with you. You know, it's like, what? You're going to go OD on me again? You know, ruin another one of my dates? And yeah, it's I think that more or less covers that one. I'm going to go, again, I'm going to go more into food service girl, but after she has been found, we see the, I guess, ambulance, yeah, something like that, and, you know, you've got these three girls standing, crying together near the ambulance, you know, they're, you know, carting out the body. But in the foreground, you know, and you have this, like, sheriff with his back turned. You have this girl talking to him, smiling, you know, and it's like maybe she's trying to pick him up, maybe, you know, something. But just the lack of respect to be standing there and just, you know, just casually. And it's obviously, it's very intentional. It's not just like randomly they were shooting and, oh, right, there's that person in the shot. No, it was, you know, that's what one of them takes from it. Ooh, police, this is exciting. You know, and, you know, yeah, maybe she wants to sleep with a cop or something. Or, you know, maybe she's trying to talk one of the, you know, talk someone into giving a, you know, lesser sentence for one of her friends, something. But the farthest thing on her mind is a girl committed suicide. Her body is like a meter from mine. That's just, that doesn't even register. And with Sean's, this is where we get the kind of fun. Okay, let me just briefly, since I'm going to be talking about some of the funnier parts, if you don't want to hear this, but, you know, just skip a little bit. I'm going to put the time codes. You know, I understand if you only want to hear the more negative, the sadder parts of the suicide attempts. And I also, you know, yeah, there was a time where I wouldn't have laughed about it, but the film, it's just the comical, yeah. So I'm going to go back to Harry. Just the entire, you know, Raymond bursting with, you know, into, was it Dell, maybe? Fell. I think he called him Fell. Harry's at Fell's, you know, and yeah, he bursts in, you know, indicates Paul and says, "I brought Paul." And the script rightly describes this as, and I believe I can quote this directly, as if it would save his life. You know, is, you know, he's bursting in, like he said, "Okay, I got the doctor. It's just, I brought Paul." You know, just, that's it, right? That's gonna fix everything. And, you know, and he is the calm one in the situation, you know. The others are just all over the place, you know, and he's like, you know, "I have a date at 7, you know, and come on, we gotta help Harry." And, you know, he's walking slowly, you know, Raymond has to like drag him when they're like silhouettes. And they get into the car and he's like, I need some cigarettes. He just does not care. And, you know, they're like, you know, "Maybe we should we pull over, maybe induce vomiting?" You know, they're all over the place. It's like, you have to calm down, sweetie. You have to calm down and try to just stay on track. I get that this is a very stressful situation, but you are not helping by jumping around. Like, at least they don't appear. We don't see them stop the car and try to induce vomiting, at least. You know, they get to the hospital, and yeah. They're talking about, you know, how he's sounding, like, you know, he's not choking or something like that. Really? Well, what do you call the sound? He's, and Paul, I don't know enough, but I think he's right. Like, he's got air trapped in his lung and he's having trouble, but, it's fine. And they get to the hospital and Paul gets out this, there's like a wheelchair right there. And the first time you see it, you're like, he's going to help Harry into that and get him to a doctor. Nope. He's going to sit there and just relax. And just, and he doesn't even go over to, he's just correcting the doctor. And even from there, he can tell that clearly Harry isn't dead. But yeah, and they walk in, please, our friend is ODing. And the nurse walks past, I'm on my break. That is so horrible and so wrong. Man, and they're like, can we get a doctor? Is anybody else here? And he walks up, and this is like, I don't really know this guy, but on the commentary, he's like a musician. He wrote like the Muppet songs or something like that. And he walks up, and he just slowly, stethoscope and checks for pulse. I'm not getting a pulse. And they're like, oh my goodness, it's horrible, and he's I'm not getting a heartbeat. And Paul is like, I can see him moving. He's not dead. And and he says, your friend has no pulse, no heartbeat. His pupils are fixed and dilated. And then, it cuts to his eyes. Even in that brief shot, you can tell his pupils are not dilated and they are not fixed, and he's not moving that much, but he's clearly not dead, and, he's like, yep, your friend is dead. And Harry is like, I'm not dead, am I? And Raymond's like, yes, you are. Shut up. And yeah, he's like, ah, I think you are. It's, your friend has gone to the bye-bye. He's gone to the big bye-bye. He's going on the paper on the backside. It's toe tag time in Teenville again. And Raymond, or maybe it's Fel, is like, Teenville? That's just, like I said in the review, these pop culture references and jokes that aren't understood. It's like, of all the reactions, it's like, it's not like, how can you be saying that about, it's like, Teenville? Just, I don't get that reference. And they're dragging him off. If you leave, leave your friend, and I'm sure I can do some tests, and I can prove to you that he's dead. And they leave, the doors, the automatic doors close, and he's still standing there. I really must insist that you bring back your friend's corpse so I can run some tests and confirm that he's dead. And like, when the, on one of the commentary tracks, they say, what is even going on? What is this doctor? And like, the actor has his interpretation, Roger Avary has his interpretation, but yeah, it's just, never mind, I guess we'll have to do without medical assistance. And they're walking out, Raymond's like, you're looking in a malpractice suit, buddy. And just, yeah, and it's just, it's so funny because there are so many so selfish people involved in the situation that just, you've got the doctor who just, he's clearly not going to help. We don't know if he's crazy, if he's just, making fun of them. Just, we don't know exactly what's going on. Raymond is like, just, constantly, he's like, make him better. I've seen this on ER, make him better. And you've got, Paul just sitting, chilling, and just, he's not dead. Can we get this over with? I have a date, and just, yeah. And Sean, Sean is upset about Lauren, and he, excuse me, Actually, just briefly finishing about Paul. It is from his perspective, and it is possible that he just... Yeah, that's how he remembers it, or how he tells it, because he just does not care about Harry's OD. So, yeah, you know, they went to the hospital, you know, the doctor said something that didn't make any sense, and then they took Harry home, whatever. It ruined the date. You know, that may well be. But, yeah, Sean, you know, that first time... The first three attempts are genuine. You know, he, like he says to Lauren later, I really did try to kill myself right before I faked it. I love his excuses and fake apologies. He hardly ever apologizes, but he's always got some reason. You know, just because I'm screwing somebody else doesn't mean I'm not faithful to you. Look, I don't make the rules. I just think them up and write them down. Yeah, he... And it's just, it's... It is kind of funny, you know, start... You know, he's... Like Carrot Top says, he's playing tent. And, you know, yeah, he gets out of that and... You know, and he was also having sex with Kelly in there, so I guess that's just how he does that. That, yeah, you know. Anyway, it's... Although, you know, that part is only his imagination, but we can imagine that he has sex in there. You know, maybe it's instead of, you know, because if Bertrand comes home, you know, gets into the, you know, shared room, then yeah. But the... Because the phone rings, he gets the idea, you know, and he rips it out, and that accidentally... turns on the radio, and it plays. They describe it as it's if the monster mash had never been invented, this is what might have been instead. And it is this hilarious little Halloween song, and just, yeah, and it's, yeah, so he rips out this, you know, the like telephone wire, you know, rips it all the way out, and then, you know, ties it around his neck all the way, and, you know, stands there on the chair, you know, puts it around the hook that, you know, and it's looking, you know, a little sad, maybe, and, you know, and he says, Lauren, and then he kicks the chair away, and then he's hanging there, and for like a second or two, you're like, and then the hook falls out, and he lands right on his ass on the floor, and then you just, you know, you shouldn't, but, okay, I'm sure some don't laugh. I'm not sure I did the first time, but the just, it's so pathetic looking, and it's so, and again, like I say in the review, at the end of the review, even from the start of the film, we don't feel that bad about laughing at Sean Bateman, because he, yeah, he's a psychopath, he says so himself, an emotional vampire. So there at the end, you know, when he's like, trying to kill himself, and then he fails, it's just, it's kind of funny, and... Yeah, then you have, like, the, you know, okay, so that didn't work. If I can't hang myself, there's got to be other stuff in here, right? And he gets the razor, and here, again, I gotta quote Carrot Top. I'm gonna shave myself to death. You know, just maybe at least one more Carrot Top joke. He, you know, points out, like, when Paul... is kicking the nuts, you know, he's like, oh, he's never kicking on a man the nuts, that's just not right, and, you know, he says, oh, he recovered from a kick to the nuts pretty fast, and then near the end of that opening scene, of parts, Paul's monologue of that, he goes, I am Paul, nutless man. That's just kind of funny. And they kind of forgot that he maybe shouldn't have been quite that, you know, that easily okay after that kind of kid. And this is one of the football players. So, or, you know, yeah, he's got the football. So, well, maybe not. It's not necessarily the one of the team, but yeah, I mean, yeah. And I mean, that kick, it's also that Paul isn't really like, I mean, he seems to do like yoga, I think it is that, you know, that morning we see, but he's not really a sports guy. I mean, he's kind of effeminate, and he's, you know, I'm not saying gay guys can't do sports. It's just, he doesn't seem like he's one, you know, and he's probably not in fights a lot. So yeah, you know, because if you've been in fights, you learn to not open your legs like that. If someone is around that is, you know, you have the reflex of covering, and yeah, and he doesn't. And yeah, it's because he's not, you know, he's not used to people trying to kick him, and, you know, yeah. So he tried to shave himself to death. That didn't work. And so, OD, you know, he's not a freshman anymore, even though he says to Kelly that he's Peter the freshman later, or intends to and then doesn't. He's going to try to OD. So he gets the cold medicine. I know that, like, a lot of stuff, like Swoosie Kurtz and Faye Dunaway were apparently actually drinking in the scene. And, you know, as soon as the person on the commentary track says, so some of their takes got a little more loose, as soon as that, I could say, oh, yeah, Swoosie is definitely, you know, she's, like, holding the glass, and she's, like, you know, and it's hilarious. I love their performances, and I love everybody's performance in this. But I really hope that they did not have James Vanderbeek chugging all that cough syrup, because that is friggin' nasty. But yeah, hopefully it was just like colored water or something. But considering all the other, yeah. Anyway, he wakes up, and I love the timing of the, you know, imagine the look on her face. You know, yeah, he probably doesn't want to see the look on her face if he was found right now. But yeah. And again, it's not like this great, it's just typical. It's just, you know, it's not this, why can't I successfully suicide? It's just typical, you know, like he's just so jaded about his suicide attempts at this point. And it is slightly unclear in the film why Lauren happens to show up at that time, and if he maybe knew that she would. In the script, apparently, like, he left a message for her, or called her directly or something. You know, it's, I'm pretty sure the film is set later than the time the thing is written. Yeah, as you know, at least one indicator that it's taking place close to when it was filmed is the mini DV camera. You know, that, yeah, that pretty much says it. I don't remember exactly how old those are, but it's not that much later than, yeah, so earlier, rather. Anyway, yeah, so, you know, in the script, apparently, like, she called, and, you know, there almost could be a line. Maybe they even shot it and just cut it. You know, when she walks in, supposedly in the script, she kind of, as she's walking in, she says, you're right, I got your message, you're right, we gotta talk. And, I mean, really, at that point, he was outside of her door, knocking and yelling in, excuse me, you know, could we please talk? And she said it's over, and yeah, and leave, Sean. Actually, she might have just said leave. So yeah, you know, maybe after that she did, you know, get, I mean, even if they are for sure ending it, I mean, he did they could maybe at least have a conversation. You know, they don't have to be, what is it, let's part as friends, you know. So, okay, maybe. I mean, at that point, not that it's not enough, but what, that, or not enough for that matter, she, what he's done that she knows of is that he slept with her roommate, and apparently it was in her bed, like in Lauren's bed, which, yeah, that, I mean, that explains why the pictures of just Lauren and then, you know, food service girl are, you know, right there on the wall. So, yeah. And in the script, it's actually, I'm glad that they changed. In the script, she actually, you know, right after she actually runs up and finds them there right after finding food service girl. I'm glad that they changed the order so that, yeah, it could take some of the impact. You know, there's still a relief, there's still some laughter afterwards, but it's not quite that. But yeah, however, in the script, it's also that she runs from that and runs to, like, the window peering in to the room of Lauren and of her and Lara, and like she you know knocks on the window or something, like screaming, still really upset, and then she sees Sean, and then she looks to Lara, and Lara looks to Sean, looks to her, and Sean looks to Lara, looks to Lauren, and then Lauren, you know, like passes out or something. That's kind of funny. That is funny. Anyway, but yeah, I do really like that, you know. She walks in and she just sees it, and there's like this look of disbelief of like, you know, it's, you know, not only, okay, so I guess you and I are not at all exclusive, like it maybe kind of sounded like we were, but you slept with my roommate, who you know is my roommate, who knows that she's my roommate. So yeah. And then, you know, he's not even, I'm so sorry. He's just like, I only did it with her because I'm in love with you. That is just, and then he gets, then he, you know, hits like with his palm against the wall or something. Like it's, that's funny. That's just, I mean, he's not really lying. He's just, yeah. But it's not really gonna work. But yeah. Anyway, so that brings back to, you know, when he fakes it to her. You know, if she just happens to walk in and he just knew, you know, figured that she'd happen to walk in or something, you know, that, that again is like, wait, what? What just happened? How did, but yeah. But yeah, you know, he's lying there with the blood, and his idea is that she's gonna walk in and think that he's dead and then realize that he's alive and be like, oh, Sean, I'm so glad you're still alive. I completely forgive you. Let's never fight again. And, you know, gives him a big hug, gets, you know, some of the blood smeared off on her neck, and, you know, and he's not even like, he's even like, gotcha. You know, because that's Sean. You know, she hurt him, so he's gonna hurt her back. You know, but it backfired. And yeah, and then there's this, you know, he goes from kind of like this, you know, cynical laugh, and then, you know, suddenly he's just not really feeling anything, and he's certainly not feeling anything positive. And yeah. And I already did briefly mention, you know, that, yeah, he apparently thinks that telling Lauren, you know, I did actually try to kill myself right before I faked it. He thinks that that's going to help, you know, that, yeah. And I believe that brings me to the, yes. That covers the other suicides. And so, food service girl. I think that her character genuinely being listed as Suicide Girl is exactly the way to go, because that really is all that she is to him. It's not clear if she's ever introduced herself to him and had a single, even brief, even superficial conversation with him. There's just, she's leaving these letters, you know, that are anonymous. And that's also something, you know, you may not really appreciate the first time you watch it, is one of the first times we see, you know, he walks in and she drops the food, and it's not her fault that it looks so nasty, you know. It's just really, you know, at least pretend. But he just, you know, slides it off and it goes in. You know, I think in the script it's like he walks over to and then dumps it in. The visual of him just sliding it, you know, and complete with the tray itself, just wow, you know, just yeah. And you know, the next time we see her, she's outside, she's standing by this tree, and he passes right next to her, and she kind of briefly looks at him. And the first time, you don't even realize that she's going to be a character. You might not even have realized that was the food service girl. But he then walks in and checks his mail and finds that anonymous letter. She just left it, and then she stood there knowing that he would walk past, and she's, you know, yeah, she's waiting with trepidation, you know, wants to be near when he opens it. And still, she doesn't go up and talk to him. There's no, yeah, you know, and then near the end, when she sees him go off with Lara, she suicides because she can't have him. And like she writes, "You probably did it just to hurt me. Well, it worked." And there is this really, when only the viewer can fully appreciate what has happened, because nobody in the film realizes that Food Service Girl was writing the letters. No one but her knows. And everyone assumes that it's, you know, yeah, Paul and Sean both, I almost called them Peter, both presume that it's Lauren. And, you know, barely even ask, you know. And, yeah, it's, only the viewer knows that she, yeah, that it wasn't Lauren seeing him walk off with Lara. Lara has sex with him pretty much as soon as possible, except that the first time she has the chance, you know, there are two different parties where they might, and she realizes that the two of them want to have sex, and maybe some part of her does, you know, when we realize that, you know, well, realize, we know from almost the very start that Lara had sex with Victor, but, you know, because it's said in the opening. But yeah, it's, you know, maybe we think that there is some sense of, like, I'll take this bullet for you kind of thing. I will sleep with Sean so that you can see that he would sleep with me. That way, the two of you won't have sex, and you won't be disappointed by having, you know, you won't regret having sex with him. You know, but, and that also seems like, you know, in the script, she's actually leaning up against the wall when she says, you know, she's never going to want to see you again, you know. And that's, again, I'm telling you, Dante's ninth circle, I know it, but it's just kind of funny when he just, and he cold cocks her. He knocks her out. It is not some kind, and that is who Sean is. And he clearly looks like there's clear satisfaction on his face. Like, yes, finally I got to punch somebody. Because he's kicking Mark's bed. He's, you know, he knows he can't do anything around Rupert. You know, he's hitting the wall with his palm when, you know, Lauren walks out. And, you know, he's not going to hit Lauren. He, you know, he could. He has chances to, but he doesn't. But Lara, you know, he had sex with her. And now she's sitting there, you know, rubbing it in his face again that they, you know, had sex and that, yeah. And he's so angry, and I think it might be Carrot Top who points, you know, now she's had a nosebleed from both of her nostrils. Rusty pipes. Like he says, that usually means you've had enough. And yeah, if it wasn't for Lara, you know, Lara sends Sean to get her another beer, and it's clear, you know, I mean, it's right there in the air, you know. I mean, when she's telling him, get me another beer, she's basically saying, you know, yeah, we can have sex. It's just, you know, he walks off, and then Paul walks up to him, and before Sean has a chance to get back with the beer, you know, so you want to have a beer? That's awesome. But yeah, it's you know, some other guy has walked up to her. Oh yeah, Jim from Dartmouth. They've talked for maybe a minute when Lauren walks in. And then Lara has already forgotten his name. That really highlights just how superficial these people, you know. This is, what was it again? They literally just started having a conversation. And it's just, or I suppose it's possible that he didn't give his name before that, but I like my way better. Yeah, you know, they would have had sex right then, you know, right, not right there, but they would have had sex right after that party if it hadn't been for Jim from Dartmouth. Brewski for Yuski. In the script, she actually also said, I think my standards are a little higher than someone whose opening line is brewski for Yuski. And yeah, it's just this. Yeah, you know, seeing him go off with Lara, you know, that's, yeah, you know, that's not new behavior for him to engage in, you know. And she even writes it in the first letter, you know, seeing you walk up, you know, with all those, you know, others. But yeah, and the scene itself of her suiciding is just devastating. It's almost the only thing in the film that you really can't laugh at, unless, you know, unless you are literally a monster emotionally. But yeah, you know, that and the yeah, you know, Paul and Lauren together briefly talking about the letters and people like him, people like us, you know, those are pretty much, I can understand people laughing at when he's beaten up by Rupert and Guest. That is kind of funny. And it is really sad when Paul, you know, is standing there and really hurt by Sean. But then he trips and falls on his ass and he's like, I'm sorry, but that's just kind of funny, because again, he's in great shape, but he's not used to like using physical force So, like, he gets, like, a snowball and throws it, and then he trips because he's not really used to this kind of, yeah, and I'm sorry, it's just kind of funny, but, yeah, the, Sean does want to be with, although he may only want sex with, the letter writer, although he might not if he knew that it was food service girl. He chooses to believe that it's Lauren. There's no real reason for him to think so. He acts as if this is like some, I mean, it was just, I don't know, maybe he believes in destiny. We know Paul doesn't, but, you know, when they meet and, you know, they were both going to the class and it was canceled, you know, like he says, this is one time he bothered to show up, and just her laugh, her adorable, cute, dorky laugh, you know, both times just gets me every time. She is so adorable. But yeah, and still, you know, sinister too. I'm like, I wish you were. Just, yeah, adorable. And a great actress. You know, I don't want to make just, you know, yeah, she's an amazing actress. I've really enjoyed her performances and everything I've seen. And she isn't, you know, at the end of this, she isn't just adorably cute and such. And, you know, there's also a little more edge to her in Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. But the, yeah, there's really no reason to think that, you know, if we didn't, well, actually, yeah, we don't know. We don't know at that point that it's not Lauren writing the letters. But, yeah, I mean, you can kind of see how, you get that he makes the connection, you know, you see the, and I just, I mean, I already talked about the split screen in the review itself. It is, yeah, I love it. It's spot on. It's so perfect. And I love that it has these kind of, you know, with both of them, you see a little bit of like morning routine. But with her, it makes her look clean. Like she's, yeah, like Carrot Top sings along, brush your teethies. She's brushing her teeth, and yeah, she looks, you know, and isn't she also like right out of the shower? Like she's got the towel on her head, I think, so she's just out of the shower too, you know, and yeah, but his morning routine, you know, he's like starting, you know, maybe starting to jerk off a little. He's like on the can, you know, and he's wiping and just, he looks positively disgusting and just awful. He is a drug dealer. I love that entire exchange where every line they speak, another line they sniff. And I love that right after, he's a drug dealer. She lowers her head out of frame and audibly snorts another, you know, and he says, you know, I put my hand on her face. She comes licking my palm and snorting. It's like, it's that, she's that used to it. And she to that extent connects coke and sex, you know, that she, yeah, she like automatically almost snorts, but yeah, the, or maybe it's just supposed to be a, you know, a dorky O face kind of thing, but whatever. I like my way better. Yeah, I love that she doesn't even really, you know, she says, ooh, drug dealer, awful, and then she uses drugs, you know, not even a second later, but yeah. Yeah, it's making her look sweet and innocent and making him look really bad. And, you know, it's not, I mean, everybody poops, so it's not that kind of, it's just, it's what it shows, you know. And he got high before going to class. She got high because class, you know, I mean, she shows up and he's like passed out. He didn't think anybody was going to show up. And apparently no one else did. They were the only two who were going to, for all we know, Bertrand was supposed to go to that class. But just, yeah, I love the bit, you know, gets the pillow thrown back in his face, and he like wobbles slightly, you know, but he doesn't go down. And then he falls back asleep and starts snoring in that position. That's how tired he is, you know, but yeah. And how little of an impact the rain, the moment it stops raining, you know, and Sean is like, he is asleep? He's asleep. And then he sticks his hand down his underpants, you know, that's, yeah, he doesn't have that many inhibitions in that regard, you know. I would like to think that if he didn't think Bertrand was asleep, that he wouldn't have put his hand down his underpants right in front of him. But I can't be sure. And they, yeah, you know, she gets to class, you know, really early, and she sees him there with, like, you know, was that, like, vodka? The script describes it as a wild turkey, and I feel like I've heard that in connection with a bottle like that before. So, yeah, and, you know, he's got the roach, and, you know, she smokes, and she's sitting there smoking for, you know, she's smoking and sitting there for so long that by the time he finally gets around to getting there, she's still there, and she's just leaving, you know, so... Yeah, you know, because he was going to be late right from the start. When it rings, he should pretty much have already been there, if I recall exactly how they are in relationship. But yeah. And the... Yeah, it's... Yeah, you know, so there's a girl that he likes and that he finds kind of innocent, and he's gotten anonymous love letters that... sound very, you know, they're not like, you know, cyber sex kind of, you know, it's not, yeah, I don't know, sexting via letter, it's not that, they're passionate, you know, so he connects the two, and yeah, okay, maybe, but the fact that, you know, and they do, they know each other's name, and she, you know, he knows that she was with Paul Denton, and she knows that he's, you know, he sells pot. She bought it off him. So, you know, but that's about it. It's still a real, like, yeah, it's a bit of a stretch. And the fact that he doesn't at some point just, again, like, maybe ask her or try to figure out, you know, and when... the, you know, when she says it's over, he says, then why have you been sending me the, you know, why are you giving me love letters? He can't accept that it might not be her, because in his world it is. So it's not then who has been sending me love letters, it's why don't you want to be with me anymore if you've been sending me love letters? It, you know, it can't be anything else, because he's that, you know, emotionally immature. To him, if one person cares about him, then, you know, there can't be two different people who maybe have slightly of a positive. It must be her. And the fact that she ever liked him must mean that she still likes him. And yeah, the you know, yeah, like I said, he wants to have sex with the, and possibly not anything else, with the writer of the letters, even when it's clear from, like, word one, pretty much, that there, you know, again, I'm not trying to badmouth anyone, but she clearly has some emotional issues, you know, the, you know, I want to kill those ugly girls you're always with, you know, if, you know, the seeds of love have taken hold, and if I can't burn with you, I'll burn alone, you know. And he's reading this, and, you know, we're hearing it in the voiceover, and he's smiling. He's like, somebody likes me, when he should be thinking, you know, Carrot Top jokes like, ah, you know, she wants to be with you forever. And it's like, this is not a good thing. This is... I mean, there's that line, Tim Minchin says that love without proof is stalking, and that is kind of what, I mean, some of it reads like just a love letter, but some of it does read like stalking. I can feel your eyes on me. You know, I look at you. Maybe you're just too scared to come up and talk to me. You know, it's this thing of, you know, and yeah, he scans the room. He scans the room for someone he wants to have sex with. The fact that they haven't had a conversation is probably that he, you know, looks at her and either he's like, she's not hot enough, or he thinks, I'm not sure I can talk her into sex, you know, something like that. So, yeah, you know, she thinks that that means that he's looking at her, when really he's just looking, period. He's scanning the room for someone to have sex with, or someone to, you know, get drugs from, or drink with, or something, you know. But yeah, and again, it's to the person that is in love with at least the image of the other person, to them, any little gesture must be towards them, you know. So when he walks off with Lara, that's to spite her. That's, you know, that's the one thing he does where she's really like, you know, and you know, with Tonight's the Night, it's also like, again, you know, you can read it sweet. I, again, kind of like Carrot Top jokes that she's got a stuttering problem. And then it cuts to, you know, Lauren and Lara, and it's like, you know, Tonight's the Night, yep, who's the lucky boy? And the, yeah, that whole conversation, and, you know, Rusty Pipes, and they just happen to be listening to that song. It's again, kind of links it in our head. We don't know that it's not Lauren until we hear her narrate the third and final letter. But again, you know, this Tonight's the Night, it's that he's reading it as positive, but, you know, she says, you know, last call. She said, you know, this is it. And she meant it. When she wrote that in the letter, she meant it. It's tonight or never. And when she saw him walk off, I mean, again, I don't want to speak ill of the dead, which in the story she ends up dead. We don't know for sure if she might have hurt him physically, if they had actually, you know, if the two of them had walked off together, or she had finally confessed to him and he tried to blow her off the way he blows everybody off, you know, or humor briefly to, you know, we don't know exactly, but it's entirely possible, you know, and that, again, I'm not trying to speak ill of people who are suicidal, but some people who are willing to hurt themselves may also be willing to hurt others. And that, again, you have to try to admit that and try to get help. And I know that, you know, you can look for help a lot of times without finding it, but there are some great sources, and maybe talk to someone who knows, numbers to call or the organizations to contact, instead of doing anything to yourself or to anybody else. But yeah, some people, if they are willing to, if they end up doing something towards themselves, they may also be willing to do, they may also be in a situation where they'll do something to someone else, and vice versa. And for all we know, Sean is just the last of many men that she's had a crush on, that, you know, severe crush on in this, you know, this cause, maybe her life, maybe ever since she, you know, ever since she entered her teen years or something. And that was it. That was the final, you know, that was the final straw. And yeah, you know, and she's been by all these times that she didn't end up with the man that pushed her further and further. She felt less and less deserving of love, less and less, yeah, more increasingly destructive and self-destructive. And yeah, and you have to wonder if she ever talked to any of these, you know, maybe she did, maybe that didn't go, maybe that went horribly, you know. Now, and maybe none of the guys would have been any good for her. And, you know, maybe she didn't know about any of, you know, obviously Sean wouldn't have been good for her. For one thing, again, I'm not sure Sean would at all have been interested, you know, the thing with Lauren was also almost like, you know, I mean, neither of them were really specifically looking to connect like that. It just kind of happened. But, you know, help that both of them were high and that it was like the first thing that happened to them that day and nobody else was around. So suddenly they felt like the only two people in the world, you know. But yeah, I mean, the fact that he never has gone up to her and yet she's seen him go off with a lot of girls means she was there. She could have, you know, she could have maybe gone up to him before he went over to talk with anyone, or, you know, yeah, she knows him. She could think she knows him. She could have tried to introduce herself at some point. And yeah, the yeah, the she, she should have talked to him. The fact that he went off with other girls whilst looking in a room that she was means that he didn't look at her and think, that's someone I want. You know, and we know that when he wants someone, it's for sex, drugs, or liquor. So, yeah, you know, for none of those. And, you know, you see the, you know, stills of where she was. And, you know, when you rewatch it, you can see she was in even more scenes. And it seems like she was at every... the parties that took place before that one and before the end of the world one, and she never seems like she's at all enjoying herself. So she maybe went to this party, maybe thinking, maybe this time I'll have fun, or maybe thinking, maybe this is the night that he finally gets up the courage and comes over and talks to me, like she writes in the letter. Maybe, you know, but she's by herself, she looks sad, and she looks lonely. You know, it's the wallflower kind of thing. And the, yeah, like the three protagonists, she has this image of her partner which isn't the reality at all. And, you know, Lara is just one of many that he has sex with. It just, you know, there is, I mean, you, yeah, you know, like she wrote, you know, tonight's night, that was last call. So, you know, she thought that, but yeah, I mean, and we know she saw him go off with a lot of other women. So, you know, and that's also, you know, and she writes, she knows, do you just use them for sex? You know, and she thinks that there's more. And that's the thing. She doesn't realize that he cannot do anything more. You know, when he thinks about Lauren, he doesn't think, I wonder what she likes. I wonder what she wants to do. You know, they do have that brief, you know, I think I might change my major to what? I don't know. What's yours? I don't know, you know, but... So, yeah, there's maybe sort of a connection, but that's the only time. He never actually, and we do hear him think about her. We hear him think about, you know, what she might be like in, you know, in bed. And that's what he thinks about. And he thinks, why do I want this girl that I think of as innocent? I mean, that's just going to ruin my idea of her being innocent. And, you know, instead of, you know, he comes so close to having a deep thought, you know, at that point he should realize, but my perception of her innocence is just that, it's a perception. If I choose to do so, I can perceive her as something that she can remain, something that doesn't get ruined. If I can't think of her as innocent once she's, you know, yeah, once she's had sex with, you know, yeah, penis and vagina, you know, maybe I should focus on something else about her that I could really get into, you know. And yeah, he just focuses on, you know, I should probably go with Lauren, but I do want Lauren, you know. But yeah, and I like that the suicide isn't just for shock value. This was a genuine subplot and is treated with respect. We just didn't realize, and we know a ton about this character, we just didn't realize that until the, yeah, you know, when you see her, when you hear her narrating the final letter, you realize that's not Lauren's voice. And then it all kind of comes together. And, you know, it may take until you see the, you know, the little montage of bits where she was in other scenes to really realize that you've seen her before and that she was always there and such. But it hits, and it hits hard, because we already know it. You know, imagine if the movie started with it or something. You know, the rape, which I'll get to, is, you know, yeah, it's less about that than, you know, that one isn't as effective. That one sets the tone. And it's really, I mean, when you look at the sex in the film, I'm not sure, is there even a single sex scene, maybe Victor's, where there's not at least one of the people involved who doesn't really want to be there, or who, you know, maybe being manipulated or something, you know. Yeah, but the suicide is also a sudden tone shift, where, you know, before pretty much everything could be seen as light, and stuff after it can be seen as light as well, some of it. Now, Roger Avary has said that Sean, he calls himself a vampire, but he isn't really. He's a shark. He has to, you know, like Sean himself says, feeding off other people's emotions. And, you know, yeah, like a shark, if he slows down, he will die. And, you know, around the midpoint, he is, you know, completely convinced about this, the love of this other person. And, you know, then he sees himself through the eyes of his loved one. And, you know, will that make him a new man? Will he hide his pain inflicted upon others? You know, and yeah, I think that's very, it's an interesting, again, you know, comparing it to his brother Patrick, the you know, how his movie goes and whether there's change there, you know, that, yeah, you know, like I said in the review of that, where else does Patrick go? Because he's where everybody wants to be, right? Excuse me. But Sean, he suddenly realizes where he actually is. And yeah, you know, I don't know where I'm going, somewhere, what was it, somewhere, it's like desolate or isolated, something, you know, somewhere far away, I hope. You know, he's going somewhere else. He's finally leaving. He is leaving this toxic environment that he has fed on, and that has fed on him. You know, he's fed on him via the drugs he deals, and yeah, him feeding on via the drugs he takes, the alcohol and the sex. And the, you know, and Roger Avary also said, you know, Paul is the moral center, you know, of the film, and at the end, after his heart has been broken, you know, he's a humanist, a realist, not bitter, but sad. And, you know, will he be more realistic in his future, you know, pursuits of love, and really, are any of us? And that, you know, Lauren has this dream of what sex will be the first time that will make her feel complete. And, you know, at the end, you know, after the serial betrayal, she's a new woman. And yeah, that really is. She has this... Yeah, I'll get to that. The, you know, when she's commenting on it, that... She, you know, in the opening, it's not the fact that she was raped. And in some holder suggests that it's anal. I'm not certain about that, because she says it, you know, he didn't know it was, that I'm a virgin and that it hurt. You know, it's possible, but I don't know. It's also not entirely certain if she has had sex other than oral. You know, it's that kind of thing of, you know, she's supposedly still a virgin because she hasn't had vaginal, but in the script, it very much sounds like she has had anal, and the script points out that any man knows, you know, his ass and his penis better than any woman does. So, you know, the guys might as well just have sex with each other. The only thing that only a woman can give them is the vagina. And, you know, they spend 9 months of their lives, you know, inside of it, working their way out, and spend the rest of their lives trying to go back in. You know, this, yeah. And, yeah, it's... I personally don't think that it's anal. It seems like it would hurt far more if that really was the case, especially if it's the first time, which she, you know, she says virgin, so yeah. But and her description of the pain is also really, really hits you right in the gut. But yeah, you know, it's not the fact that she's being raped, it's not the fact that it's being filmed, it's the fact that it's a townie. That's the part that, you know, when people find out about how she lost her virginity, it was to a townie. That's such an embarrassing, you know. And yeah, you know, it was supposed to be her losing her virginity, and that was, yeah, you know, nothing else about the sex really mattered that much. The negative parts of it, you know, it just, this was a bad way to lose her virginity. That's the part that bothers her, not the, yeah, you know, the, and yeah, she's internalized the rampant rape culture in college. The fact that the sex started before she was even conscious, and that they barely even realize, you know, her waking up. The, you know, that doesn't, you know, and the fact that it was filmed also doesn't, you know, she doesn't describe this in her narration. And the fact that it's someone she may not even have been properly introduced to. I mean, yeah, it's the townie that he was talking to before she went over to him. And I think he is still there. You know, I think it's, you know, the he's sitting next to them on that, you know, ratty old couch. But yeah, it's still that. Yeah, it's still. It certainly wasn't the person she expected. It wasn't the person that she invited into the room. And, you know, the fact that him throwing up on her just makes, you know, he's just like, ugh, that I really needed that. That makes me feel better. That, it's just the fact that it's her virginity. And she has this idea about that that's going to be magical, that's going to be special. She, you know, like a lot of other girls, she was raised to believe that, yeah, it was, you know, supposed to make her feel complete, that that is when she becomes, you know, yeah, it has to be with someone that, you know, it will always be special, you know. And she describes it, you know, it was going to be, it probably wouldn't have hurt with Victor, and he would have taken me in his big, strong drama major arms. He would, you know, have expertly removed my bra. You know, he would be completely, you know, he would be a gentleman about it. He would be experienced enough, because that's okay for men. Men just learn from, you know, men use that to become good enough for women, but women should only do it once because they only have the one, you know. And yeah, it's the fact that, you know, yeah, and it wasn't Victor, it wasn't even Sean, it was a townie. The fact that it's not just bad sex, it's not just the, you know, it's not just a bad first time sexual experience. It's rape. That doesn't, you know, warrant mentioning in the first person perspective narration. You know, the, yeah, the, like I said, the rape culture, she's just, because she's at the party, and she's talking to guys, and she's drunk. I mean, she's in college. Of course she, you know, they can do what they want with her. It's, yeah, the, and, you know, the fact that they even, you know, she doesn't even cry for help when the, which, you know, I'm not victim blaming at all. I'm saying this, she should be allowed to, she should feel allowed to, and she doesn't. And yeah, you know, when they come in with the keg, even though, you know, she, yeah, she wants it to end, she doesn't, but yeah, it's not. And, you know, we know that it probably would have been bad with Victor too. You know, he would want her to be more experienced, be, you know, up for more, you know, the, and she also, she has this idea that the fact that they've been apart for all that time, that they're still just a couple. And we don't know what the reality, we didn't see the scene of the two of them together, but apparently she had a chance to let him have sex with her, you know. And that's the thing, you just let him. It's not, you know, I should have had sex with me, I should have let him have sex with me, because sex is something that men do to women, that women either allow or have done to them. And either way, it's, you know, this is what the woman's there for. That's that kind of mentality. And I wish I didn't feel the need to say that it was clear that saying something like this, it, you know, that No one actually believed in these things, but sadly, that's not the world we live in. Yeah, we don't know exactly their relationship before he left, but that she would think that there would... I mean, let's hypothetically say that they had a relationship, and let's hypothetically say that we didn't really know that he was having a ton of sex on the trip. It's still, I mean, they would have had to have a very, like, yeah, either a relationship or they were open and it was just, well, when he comes back, they get back together. Or that, yeah, you know, it's not very realistic that a couple, yeah, they would have to have a very serious relationship before he went anywhere for them to make that kind of commitment. And, you know, she isn't, I mean, Lara keeps trying to talk her into having sex with someone else, you know, and she doesn't, you know, when she walks up to him, you know, up to his room, where we get the dynamite, you know, Victor tests came back positive, be careful. I don't know if that means that he's been tested since he came back, if he's already had sex with someone who was being tested since he came back, or what exactly, but that is just a fantastic little detail there. And the ruler and the drawing on Sean's as well, seen when she finds him with the blood, yeah. Pretty much everything that, you know, like that. Also the magazine that Guest is reading, but yeah. I'm not sure I'm gonna go too much into it. Everything about Rupert and Guest is awesome, so yeah. Anyway, yeah, when she walks up to the door, she doesn't seem like she's going to, you know, admit and apologize that she, you know, gave the teacher a hummer, which, you know, obviously, I mean, it was basically him kind of making her. She didn't really want to, but when she, you know, nevertheless, it happened, and, you know, if they were going to be true to each other, and she has basically been trying to, more or less. She was definitely thinking about doing it with Sean, and might have if Lara hadn't, you know, I mean, she openly lies, you know, oh, she's out of town, so you can't have her tonight, but you can have me, and she won't know, you know. But, yeah, and it's mentioned on one of the commentary tracks, and I think it bears repeating. More of the, you know, college-aged straight males stormed out during the gay, you know, man-on-man kiss than during the suicide scene. That really says a lot. And, you know, near the end, they say, you know me, what does know me even mean? Maybe he means the biblical sense. Knowing Sean, that probably is. And I do think that it's interesting that in this movie, it's the pink-haired girl following, you know, in this case, Victor. I think that, you know, the various betrayals, you know, I mean, Lauren is betrayed twice by Lara, you know, both cases by Lara having sex with someone that she knew that Lauren was interested in. Even she's waving to Lauren from, you know, she's bouncing on the bed and going, oh, hi, I see you there. You know, just, yeah. And, you know, yeah, and once by Sean and once by Victor. And, yeah, the when Victor comes back and, you know, talks about his entire trip, and literally, I mean, it boils down to, I had a lot of sex, I did drugs, you know, my sightseeing was superficial, you know. Now that they've cleaned the 16th something like that chapel, it looks kind of fake. There are people who would give anything to see it once. You were there, you videotaped it, and you, well, Roger Avary videotaped it, and that's what you have to say about it. You know, it's just, wow. And yeah, you know, superficial sightseeing, you know, drank a lot, and just, yeah, you know, there was nothing else to it. And yeah, and you know, and then, you know, Mitchell is like, ah, I gotta go there. You know, that's what he takes away from it. You know, I want to have a lot of sex and a lot of drugs. And he even says, you know, oh, I'm having a monogamous relationship. So, you know, and they talk about, you know, apparently he used to date a girl named Paige, and they said, oh, yeah, she had issues, you know, but now I'm dating this girl named Candace, and we're having a lot of sex. And that's it. You know, Victor doesn't ask about what Candace even looks like or what she, anything. It's just sex, you know. And, you know, and yeah, Mitchell is like, you know, oh, I gotta go there, you know? No, you don't know. I know. You won't know until you've been there. You know, yeah. And, you know, and Sean is sitting there, you know, playing with the sugar, you know, yeah, thing. And then, you know, he kind of wants to be part of the conversation or something, you know. And then he says, you know, I've met someone, and, you know, then they start talking, what, is she, like, too young or something? And I love that, you know, after Victor has said some that are pretty nasty himself, Mitchell says, the one, you know, old enough to pee, old enough for me. And Victor's like, yeah. Mm-hmm. Just... that was certainly a thing you just said. And just, again, you know, the rape culture, he doesn't say, that's disgusting. He's just, yeah, you know, and yeah. And Sean is like, you know, trying to talk about, you know, and he sounds, you know, it's not the right crowd to be having that conversation with. But yeah, he's not, he is sounding kind of sappy and such. And then, you know, yeah, he walks off. I love the abuse of Mitchell. He's just so funny. And I like Tomasino Nicholas. You know, I haven't really seen him in too much of, you know, just this and American Pie 1 and 2, you know, possibly some other stuff. But yeah, it's just funny when he's, you know, not, you know, great mood. You know, the whole, you know, when he first meets Paul and Paul's dancing up to him, dancing up against him. And I warned you. Of course, I know. I you know, I remember. Warn me about what? And he keeps going, I warned you, and I'm warning you again. Just, you know, and it's this, you know, I'm with Candace now. And Paul sees her, and it's like, hi, and then it's scream, you know. And I love that Candace apparently wants a three-way. And apparently that's something that, like, the actress came up with right before they filmed or something. And then, you know, Mitchell is like, no, I really think, you know, and she's also just saying, I mean, she's basically saying in plain English, I want to have sex, let's go have sex, you know, and, you know, I have a place, you and I have genitalia that match, that, you know, not saying that, you know, don't, yeah, and then she's like, would you like to, ah, come on, you know you'd like to. Maybe next time, you know, just the whole, yeah. And then, you know, he's sitting there and, you know, Sean, you know, they're sitting there, Victor, Sean, him. And Sean gets up fast and he, you know, he had like his legs crossed and on the seat next to Sean. So when Sean gets up, you don't really see it, but he's like shoving his legs out. And we know, I mean, this is what Sean does. When he passes someone, he shoves them, you know. Paul, you know, he doesn't he skip in line with Paul too, and excuse you, and he looks at him and he's like, he doesn't even really it doesn't register with him that he just did something that bothered someone, because he's entitled, you know. And yeah, so he, and as usual, you know, he takes something from someone. So he says, you know, I'm driving your car, you know, and he stole the book from, well, he might have borrowed it, but he definitely took Mark's book. He would like to take something from Rupert. And, you know, does he? I think the drugs he throws it, you know, into Mitchell's car were some he already had, but I'm not certain. It might have been that he took, but he would like to take from Rupert. He already did. But he, you know, would you like some coke? Yeah. Then buy your own. I love. He's so. I haven't seen. Was it Clifton Young? I don't remember. Clifton Collins, maybe. I don't remember. But he's awesome in this. I love him in this. Every line, the eyes, just the paranoia and rage and the karate he does over to him. You know, and you will be incapable of firing your weapon, you know, and just, yeah, the whole thing, just, yeah, anyway, yeah, Sean gets up, and he's walking out, and Victor's like, you know, I mean, he just got back from Europe, he's out, he already did all his dope, so, you know, can I buy some, you know, how much, 3 grams, 300, yeah, that might be Rupert's kind of math. I don't know the rate on it, but that might be, yeah, Rupert's, I love that exchange too, you know, how much more could you, you know, and the, you know, I need you, like, elbow, yeah, you know, how much more do you think you could get? 20%, 50%, you say, that is, you know, do we have ourselves a deal? Welcome to Buford T. Pleasure County. Yeah, just, yeah. I also real quick in the script he actually does call Patrick. He calls him twice. First near the start to, you know, and both times he's talking about the money that he owes Rupert. And the second time, yeah, it's, I think it is right after he's been at Rupert's the second time, and he calls, and the second time Patrick agrees. So he's possibly not lying, you know, it's not in the film anymore, so, you know, but, yeah, and it's still, I mean, Rupert's line still makes sense, you know, it was that easy, huh, you know, and it's like, and, you know, Carrot Top points out that he got off easily from being beaten like that with just that little bit. That is true. I do think they're not necessarily interested in killing him, because, you know, even though he aimed the gun at him, but, you know, when they were running, but he does want someone to sell the dope on, you know, on Camden campus, and he's not a big fan of leaving. You know, that's the great thing. Rupert never leaves his house, and then a little bit later he did, you know, and that's also, he knows where you are, dude. You know, it's not like he's not gonna be able to, yeah. It is pretty ridiculous that he actually shows up the second time, and I love, you know, just the man we were looking for. Then he goes in, you know, he takes off the coat and starts looking tough, and, you know, Rupert stops what he's doing, you know, carving the, yeah, and, you know, gets rid, the machete comes out and the whole, yeah. Anyway, I'm gonna do what the movie does a few times and rewind. Yeah, he, you know, he wants 3 grams, you know, $300 up front, and, you know, he won't let them go at first. I don't trust you. That's too bad, you know, and take Mitchell with you. What? And he's like, you know, and what? Go get with him, you know, and okay, we're taking your car and I'm driving, because he's always taking things from people. The one time he, you know, when he meets Lauren that first time, she takes from him, you know, she keeps his sunglasses. But yeah, so that's the one time, you know, and he is able to give, but it's not, he doesn't usually, you know, it says a lot about the character, the different things he takes and the way he's, yeah, and when he doesn't take and the one time he gives. But yeah, you know, Mitchell runs out and, you know, they start driving. And Sean, he's not looking at the road at all. He is like, oh man, the stereo, and this is a nice car. I didn't know they came in banana. And just, you know, yeah, it's a nice car, so I don't want you to crash it. You know, just chill. Okay, I'll chill. My car is going to be used to do a drug deal, but I'm just going to chill. You know, and I don't need to do this. You do. If your girlfriend doesn't get nose candy, she's not going to sleep with you. So, you know, you need this, so we do it on my terms, okay? And, you know, and they drive up, and he's like, you know, he opens, it's dark. Maybe nobody's home. You know, Mitchell, he's like, please, you know, he hopes that he can get out of this with minimal personal injury. And, you know, it's, Rupert never leaves his house. And, you know, come on. You know, just going to, I think I'll just sit in the car, you know. And he apparently doesn't lock it because he easily gets in. But yeah, it looks like he doesn't lock it. So yeah, good luck with keeping that ride. I mean, yeah, it's like suburbia, something like that, that Rupert's, you're still going to have trouble. He's not even going to lock it. But yeah, and I love that Sean keeps the keys and Mitchell locks himself in there and then at first won't let, you know, Sean in. How are you going to get away from there, you dumb? Yeah. Anyway, yeah, so they, you know, they go in and I love his little reaction, you know, when the, you know, locks and then the side thing opens and he's just like, whoa. And you know, in the commentary track, apparently like suddenly, or maybe that's the scene in the kitchen, but yeah, suddenly James Vanderbeek had the gun and he, you know, pulls it on him. And apparently Thomas Ian Nicholas didn't know that the camera was rolling. So that's, yeah. Anyway, they walk in and at first Guest is like, oh, well, maybe this is, and you know, you've got several townies in there and the big muscular guys. And you know, they walk in and Guest says, oh, look who showed up. He says some Rasta Jamaica thing. You know, I can't, you know, I'm kind of like Patrick Bateman in that one deleted scene. I can't do the Jamaican thing in any kind of comfortable, yeah. And you know, Rupert stops carving and he's like, well, look who showed up. Sean. Who's your friend, Sean? This is Mitch. Mitch. Are you a cop, Mitch? I'm not a cop. Come on, does Rupert, does he look like a cop? I don't know. Unless the guy's got a bong sticking out of his mouth. I might assume that he's 21 Jump Street. I'm not 21 Jump Street. I don't even know what that means. That was the, you know, what was it? The Johnny Depp's and was it some Greco? I don't remember the exact names. You know, that was their big, you know, breakthrough role or something. You know, where have you been? He's not a cop. You know, come on. Obviously, he's not a cop. Obviously. Do you have the money you owe me? And then, you know, we're just here to buy 3 grams. And gives him money. 300? You owe me $3,000. You know, this. And yeah, it's like, okay, wait for what? You owe me a lot of money. Okay. Mitchell has it. What? I don't know what's going on here. I just came for some blow, man. And he's like, you know, Mitchell, give him money. Do you have my money? You know, as tell him, Sean, tell him. Okay. He doesn't have your money. You know, do you have my, no, but I have this. And he ducks under the tape. He gets the, you know, and Guest comes at him with the machete. He gets the carving, electrical carving knife into the arm. So, you know, Guest drops the machete. He picks it up and Mitchell, he crawls on the table and they like grab him. I never quite pick up where exactly he gets the bloody nose, but you know, somewhere along the line. And he picks up, he's throwing like, I don't know, it looks like, you know, maybe a bag of uncooked your pasta or something, throws it at the head, and he's like spraying at them. Because it's a kitchen. What is there that's that dangerous other than the machete and the knife? You know, he's away from the knife drawer, so, you know, and Sean, you know, as they're running out, Sean is like holding it as if it's a freaking lightsaber. It's not gonna do anything against the gun. And yeah, he holds it, and you know, the Rupert's out, you know, with the gun. He throws the machete at him, and he ducks, and you know, comes up. Then he does the slide over the car hood that we knew that was coming. It had to come in this kind of, yeah. And he's, Mitch, I have the keys, you know. And okay, he unlocks, you know, he gets in, starts driving, and they just run, you know, drive off. And you know, Rupert gets in, you know, can't shoot him. It's just, and there's supposed to be a car chase scene. They apparently filmed it, but didn't include. It was in the script as well, but it was like, you know, they outrun them because the, you know, I think they have like a pickup truck, the Rupert and the guys. And, you know, it is like a sports car or something. And, you know, they get all the way back. And then, you know, they show up a little later, obviously. But, yeah, and, you know, Mitchell is like yelling at him. And, you know, oh, come on, take the keys from me. You know you want to. And you just can't quite. And, yeah, it's just, it's so funny. He's spitting in my car, man. And, you know, he tries to stop the blood. And, you know, he doesn't want anyone to see him. So opens like the mirror and sitting there trying to, it's just funny. That's, I mean, if I was involved in one of these situations, I would be Mitchell. I'm not like, you know, I'm not punching down. I am like punching sideways. It's a lateral kind of, I, you know, I'm laughing at myself. Don't worry. I wouldn't be Sean in the situation. I would definitely be Mitchell. And the, yeah, but yeah, you know, when Sean finds that Lauren doesn't want to be, you know, she, you know, who else do you have? My boyfriend, Victor, you know, last time he saw Victor, you know, he was kind of being pwned by Victor. He was, you know, yeah, it was kind of, yeah. And he feels like he was trying to defend her honor with Victor. You know, he, you know, how can you be with Victor after what he said about you? I defended your honor. I called you innocent and virtuous. And he, you know, he called you, yeah, I'm not gonna use the word he, but it's cool because they're fun and they like to dance, you know. It, yeah, other than the word he used, I, yeah, but yeah, it's just the, yeah, it just, it's that extra layer, you know, of the, yeah. And the, I suppose that pretty much covers it. I like the various scenes of, you know, Paul over and over with these, you know, closeted guys, or maybe they are now straight, or maybe they're bi, but they, you know, nobody will accept if they say bi, so they go for straight. You know, Mitchell with Candace, and you know, the guy at the very start, you know, and Sean, of course. And I like that apparently in the book as well, it's not quite clear. We know that Sean spent the night in, you know, in Paul's room, and we don't see a roommate. So we don't know if they did do anything. It is possible that Sean is also closeted. Apparently in the book, there are passages where Paul describes all these sexual encounters between the two, but in Sean's, you know, yeah, when Sean describes, he doesn't mention anything about them at all. But, you know, this might mean that Sean is in denial about it, rather than that Paul is. You know, we don't know for sure. And Paul certainly is very into Sean, if this is a guy that he never really, you know, I mean, he knows that Sean is at the very least also into women, you know, and it's this, he thinks that it's a date, you know, he's, you know, I wish I had a case of beer, quesadilla, Mexican food, El Sombrero, I closed a long time ago, yeah, I mean, like, tomorrow night, I don't know, I'm buying, you're buying, totally buying, okay, sure, and Paul thinks that's a date, you know, and Sean forgot about it. Sean wasn't like waiting up and where is he? He forgot, you know, well, I guess it's not so much this, but then they never do seem to have a phone, but cell phone. But yeah, it's, you know, he genuinely thinks that they are kind of sort of going steady in spite of how little evidence towards that there, you know, when they're there in the morning, you know, and that's also, that might suggest that they didn't do anything. Sean is just watching this, you know, straight, well, I guess lesbian porn, but, you know, male gaze, yeah. And and Paul is annoyed because he's, I'm right here, you know, and he's like, oh, those are definitely fake. Yeah, but I like the feel of fake. How can you say that? You know, it's, again, I don't have anything against gays. I'm not trying to make fun of him as being gay. I'm more making fun of him as being someone who's in love and utterly, it just does not get that the other person is not into him at all. And again, you know, we are allowed to laugh at these people. They are quite clearly really awful people. But yeah, it's just, it is possible that there is more than that. You know, and he also later says, you know, I have ongoing conversations with you in my head. You know, that's like, ah, in love. But that also makes a lot more sense if they've had more conversations than we've seen, you know, and more stuff has happened between them, you know. But yeah. And I'm gonna go with Richard. the whole part of the movie is just hilarious. The dancing on the bed, and yeah, Richard's behavior through and through, and yeah, this whole thing. And I love the mother-son relationship with both, because that's, you know, that's the cliche, you know, the close relationship to the mother, you know, for these effeminate, you know, gays. And, you know, although I suppose Richard isn't that effeminate, he's maybe, you know, that's maybe why, you know, the script notes that by no accident, you know, Richard looks like Sean. You know, he has a bit of a type. That's the same type that he shows at the start of the film with the, you know, he'll do. You know, Gaison, definitely. You know, Mitchell is really the only person who doesn't fit that type that we really see him pursue. And it is possible that Mitchell changed his look over the, you know. But, yeah, the, you know, as part of trying to get away from seeming gay, you know, the, yeah, when the parents, you know, I love that Swoosie and Faye are in different, like, their reactions to the situation are completely different. Like, right from the start, you know, and you know, Susie, of course, says, oh, will my suffering never end? You know, all of the characters, like, Sean says typical. You know, the Paul has that almost kind of predestination, you know, just, I knew this was going to happen, and, you know, Lauren says, I always knew it was going to be this way. I feel like Raymond also says, will my suffering never end? Or something quite like that. Maybe tortures never end. But yeah, you know, Swoosie is like, ugh, that's my son. He's just this, you know. And Faye, I mean, she's just really embarrassed for the, you know, and Paul is also just, you know, Paul, he's not necessarily surprised, but yeah, you know, and he's like, he's, you know, Richard's smoking and everything he says has to do with sex. And then he starts, you know, yelling and he walks off. I love that, you know, when he first, you know, when he's yelling, leaving the table, one of the guys, like down in the lower left, I think, one of these rich guys, you know, he gets up and like just insulted. I will not eat in a restaurant that has that kind of behavior. You know, just hilarious. And like the piano player, like, is he gone? Okay. Plays on, you know, and just, yeah. But the, yeah, just throughout, like, Swoozy, she kind of goes along, okay, what do you want to be called? Okay, let's talk school, you know, and Faye is like, okay, you know, would you like another one? Yes, I mean, no, Paul, give her another. Thank you, Paul. And, you know, and at the very start and then at the very end, you know, talking about the stolen Cadillac, and you, the police, they didn't care at all, and they, you know, insurance is going to take care of it. Yeah, insurance is going to take it. I don't know. I mean, unless there was something really expensive in there, it was a stolen car. It wasn't like a murder. She lives in a big city, as far as I don't remember. Was it New York that they were in from? It's like, they can't find every stolen car. They do have really important things to do. But yeah, you know. But it's okay, because I was bored with the color anyway, you know. And then there at the end, once he's left, and once everyone has calmed down just a little, it's not, you know, is he okay? Is there something we do? It's just, I think my next car is going to be blue. A dark, dark blue. What do you think, Paul? And he's just sitting there with his eyes closed. Blue. Just, yeah, love that entire scene. Love all four performances. Love every single time that Richard is using his foot to put Paul in an uncomfortable position. Because, I mean, clearly they're into each other. You know, I mean, at first he's like, you know, oh, you're still turning me on. But, you know, I mean, they have a thing for each other. But the moment that his mother is there, he's like, yes, mother, you know, and that was there with the phone as well, you know, there's this guy I really want to have sex with, and if I don't have sex with him soon, he's going to have sex with someone else. He might have sex with a girl. If he has sex with a girl, I know this, I might not get to have sex with him again, because he's going to only go for girls then. And it's, yeah, she only gradually, I love that Sean doesn't even realize that the porn has been muted. He doesn't realize that, you know, that Paul is on the phone until he mutes the porn. And at that point, you know, okay, he doesn't unmute it. But it's like, you know, that's the one time he respects someone else's space. And then immediately, you know, he's like, ah, I gotta get cable. And then he goes over, you know, gay music. I'll take this, you know, I'm borrowing these. You know, whatever. Yeah, we'll see. You know, just, yeah. I don't want to leave you right here. Deal with it or something. Yeah. But just, yeah, he's, you know, he clearly really respects and cares about his mother, and Richard so doesn't. And it's just, yeah. And I think that might cover everything. Talked about Rupert, Richard, Mitchell, Victor. I don't have a lot to say about the travelogue. Just, yeah, it's awesome. It really just spot on. And, you know, I hope at some point they do release the full version. But, you know, I understand it's like licensing is going to be ridiculous to pay for. So, it, you know, yeah, that's really annoying. But, yeah. And, you know, I love Mark, the little bit, you know, you may notice that I don't have any clocks in my room, because clocks just mess up your your internal perception of time, you know, and the whole thing. And then he starts playing the clarinet, and then he takes, you know, can't quite deal with the cigarette in his mouth, so he takes the cigarette, places it in his, you know, like, navel, and then he keeps playing, stop kicking my bed, stop, it's all my, stop going, yeah, I'll get you money, you know, just, and it's like, he's clearly rich, but he's not gonna pay because he's just, he's gone, you know, and his reaction to, you know, to getting another fix is just, I love it. And the, I suppose, talk about their various meetings with each other. I think that covers everything. Lara is great. You know, suddenly walking on her hands and, yeah, just all of it, just so good. I think that covers it. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.